meet you and have the opportunity to hear you speak this evening.
Thank you. Thank you very much. It's good to meet you, too. It's my great privilege and joy to share what God has done in my life so that I could see young men and young women forsake the things of this world so that they can find the greater joy in bringing others to Christ.
That reminds me, I was going to mention, it is customary after events like these to take up a collection for your mission agency. I'll make sure to record that in the evening for sure.
I appreciate the thought, friend. However, I would ask that there be no collection taken, and really any reference to it be completely avoided.
I've got to admit, that's the first I've heard of any such request. Regardless, sir, I will honor your wish.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Good evening, my brothers and sisters in Christ. It is my extreme privilege this evening to share with you the work that God is doing in the interior of China. In doing this, though, I feel it is a helpful thing for you to hear the story of how God has brought me to this place. It is always helpful for us to fix our attention on the Godward aspect of the Christian work and to realize that the work of God does not so much mean man's work for God as it does mean God's own work through man. See, it is God who brought me to this place. And I have learned over the years that God's promises are quite true, reliable, and can be trusted completely. Two such promises that I have learned to love over the years come from the very words of Jesus. One, on that day on the mountain when he was speaking to the crowds there, the Mount of Olives, he said, "Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these other things will be added unto you." And as we know, all these other things refer to our basic human needs. The second promise that has stuck with me over the years came from the words of Jesus as well when he commissioned his disciples. And he sent them out and he told them, "Lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age." God has proven both these promises true to me over and over and over again in my life. Unfortunately, however, there was a time in my life when I wanted nothing to do with God or his promises. Even then, though, God was at work. Many years ago, before my birth, probably around 1830, the heart of my dear father was deeply stirred for China. His circumstances were such, though, that his going to China would never be possible. But he was led to pray that if one day God would give him a son, that he would grant that son and he would privilege that son to labor in the needy empire of China. I myself was unaware of this prayer until more than 7 years after I left for China the first time. What is interesting to me is that the prayer offered before my birth had been answered. Unfortunately, though, my early life is full of sad examples of where I would be if it wasn't for the prayers of my parents.
And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through him. He that believeth on him is not condemned, but he that had believeth is condemned already, because he hath not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. And this is the condemnation, that the light is come into the world, and men love the darkness rather than the light, because their deeds were evil. For every one that doeth evil hateth the light, and neither cometh to the light, lest his deeds should be reproved. But he that doeth truth cometh to the light, that his deeds may be manifested as having been wrought in God. Let us pray. Lord, please bless the reading of thy word, and may it impact our lives in this day. In Jesus' name, amen. Hudson, I've noticed you've been frequently rubbing your eyes, and I'd like to take a look at them. Hold on 1 second. I will go get my glass.
Hudson, are your eyes bothering you?
I suppose so.
For how long?
Oh, I don't know. For a little while. I think it has something to do with the gas lamps at the bank. They hurt when I'm trying to balance the ledgers.
Why didn't you tell your father about this?
Because he would just make me quit my job.
Well, if the job is causing you problems, perhaps you should.
But I like my job. I have lots of friends there.
It seems to me some of your friends are a bad influence on you.
I don't know. You would think that because they're not Christians. But I know some Christians who live their lives just the same as unbelievers. There doesn't seem to be any difference with them.
Well, there should be a difference if they're truly believers.
I'm trying to keep an open mind. Some of my friends have pretty interesting ideas. We've had some very thought-provoking discussions at work. It seems that the Christian life is just filled with religious duties that, to me, are somewhat frustrating.
Hudson, you're breaking my heart with that kind of talk. If your father heard you, I just don't want to think about it.
Fine, I won't mention it. I wouldn't want to make him angry.
Well, I like being a Christian and hearing Father read from the Bible.
That's because you're a girl and you're very young.
Hudson Taylor, you're bad. You need to repent.
Louisa, don't you think it's time to get ready for school?
I'm all ready, ma'am. I just need to brush my teeth.
So go and do that now, dear. You too, Amelia.
Yes, ma'am.
Hudson, please do not speak like that in front of the girls. They are very sensitive. They both have good hearts and deeply love the Lord. You'll only upset them when you talk like that.
I'm sorry.
Okay, Hudson, let's take a look at your eyes. Look up, down, blink. How long did you say they've been hurting?
For several weeks, I suppose.
Is it worse during the morning or at night?
At night, I think.
He thinks it has something to do with the gas lamps at the bank.
Well, that makes sense. Son, I don't want you working at the bank anymore. Both of your eyes are badly inflamed.
Can't you just give me something for it? I don't want to quit my job. I like my job.
This is a serious problem, son. You could go blind. The only hope for a full recovery is total rest.
I can't believe it. I have to stay in all the time.
Son, I have already lost 2 other sons. I am not going to lose another if I can help it. I will go to the bank and explain everything to them. I don't want to hear any more whining about it. Do you understand?
Yeah.
Now, I have to be going downstairs. I have some appointments in a few minutes. Dear, please get him some rags to put over his eyes.
Yes, dear.
I can't believe it. Why am I always sick? It has been like this all my life. I knew that job at the bank was too good to last. No more work, no more laughing with the other clerks. Instead, I'll be stuck at home all day. It's so unfair. Every time something starts to go right for me, I get sick.
Dear, it's only until your eyes get better.
No, Father won't go let me work at the bank, especially if he thinks those lamps are the cause. He just wants me to take over his practice someday, and I just don't want to do that with my life.
I think you would make a fine chemist. Let's not worry about that now, dear. Let's just concentrate on you getting better.
You wouldn't understand, Amelia.
I suppose not. Did Father say your eyes are bad?
Yes, he said I could go blind, so I have to rest. I can't work at the bank anymore. I have to stay in all the time. Guess that means I don't have to go to church either. I won't miss that, but I'll miss the bank and my friends there. I'll just end up being a chemist like Father.
Is that so bad? Father seems to really like it. Don't you want to be like him?
Father is a Christian, first and foremost. I'm not. I've really tried to make myself a Christian, but I just don't think I can be saved. There's just no hope for me beyond the grave. But I've also talked with a lot of people who don't believe that Jesus is the only way, and who knows, perhaps they're right and our parents are wrong.
Amelia, whatever he is saying to you, well, just keep praying for your brother.
I had many opportunities in the early years of learning the value of prayer and of the Word of God. For it was the delight of my dear parents' heart to point out that if there were any such being as God, that to trust Him and to obey Him must be the wisest course of action for anyone. But in spite of these helpful examples, my heart remained unchanged. Often, I tried to make myself a Christian, and I failed in such efforts, of course. I began at last to think that it was impossible for me to be saved, and that the best thing I could do was to take my fill of this world. But what a kind, compassionate, long-suffering Father that we have. He finally answered the prayers of my parents, and come to find out, the prayer of my sister as well. One afternoon, when my mother was visiting her sister for a few weeks, I was feeling bored. I had finished my work for the day, and I knew that if I was left with nothing to do, my sister Louisa would certainly see that and take advantage of that and ask me to play paper dolls with her. I did not want to do that. And I knew that if my father saw me idle, he would most certainly find a chore for me to do. So I decided I needed to look busy. And that's when I found it, one of my father's pamphlets. I had looked at these pamphlets before, and I knew how they went. There was this exciting story at the beginning, which would then lead into the gospel message. Being the wise young man that I was, I figured I'd read the exciting part, but skip the end.
I have really enjoyed the time we've had together, sister.
I have also. I have so much free time here. I hardly know what to do with it. At home, there's always so much to do.
I feel bad that I will be leaving you alone for so long this afternoon. Will I go to my appointments in town?
Please don't. I'm actually looking forward to the solitude. I believe the Lord wants me to spend this afternoon in prayer for someone very special to me. He has laid a heavy burden upon my heart.
Well then, I will leave you to it. I should be back before dusk. Goodbye.
Goodbye.
I can't stop shaking, Mom. I'm terrified. I'm really scared.
He seems to have strayed so far from you. I often wonder if he even knows you. He has no desire for the things of God, for prayer, and for attending church. I can tell he does not enjoy any of it and seems so helpless, so frustrated, and so very lost. Won't you please touch him? Won't you please draw him by your Holy Spirit to yourself? Save him, Lord. Please save him.
The finished work of Christ. The finished work of Christ. Incredible. I just finished the whole book. What was that phrase again? The finished work of Christ. Why does the author use this expression? Why doesn't he just say, the atoning work of Christ? It is finished. Christ said that on the cross. What was finished? A full and perfect atonement and satisfaction for sin. The debt was paid by the substitute. Christ, he died for our sins, and not only for ours, but also for the sins of the whole world. If the whole work finished and the whole debt paid, if it is finished work, then there is nothing I can do but accept that finished work. Why have I never seen this before? Lord, thank you that you have finished the work and there's nothing more I can do to complete it. God, this frees my mind. Please come into my life.
Lord, I praise you for what you have done. I know deep inside that you have answered my prayer. I'm not sure how, but I'm sure you have saved my son Hudson.
In that moment, I did not know of all that was going on the same time that day. But what I did know is that God had given me eyes to see. He had given me a heart to love him. I felt a real peace inside from that moment on. And I knew my mother would be excited to hear of my news. But it was still yet to be a few weeks before she would return. So I did my best to not let anyone know of my news. I wanted my mother to be the first to know.
You've been acting really strange lately.
Hudson's always acting strange.
Well, I mean more than usual. I don't know what it is, but it seems as though you know a big secret.
Do you know a big secret? Tell us.
If I told you, it wouldn't be a secret, would it?
Hudson, you're no fun. I'm gonna go play. Hey, Amelia, do you want to play paper dolls with me?
I can't right now. I have chores to do. Why don't you
Hudson!
I have a lot of reading to do. I can't, Louisa.
Oh, you're always reading these days. Guess I'll just go play by myself.
All right, then.
Smooth move, brother.
I suppose it wouldn't hurt me to play with her every once in a while.
There you go again. You are acting really different.
Nonsense.
I mean it. It wouldn't hurt you to go play paper dolls with Louisa. That's not the Hudson Taylor I know. You are nicer than usual. You clean up after yourself more than you used to. And don't think I haven't noticed that you are reading the Bible on your own. You've really changed, Hudson. You know, one might think you've become a Christian. Hudson, is that it? It is. You have, haven't you?
Shh, not a word. I was waiting till Mother came home so she could be the first to know. It just happened a couple weeks ago.
Well, that makes sense. That was when the changes began.
Swear you won't tell a soul.
Well, I won't swear, but your secret is safe with me. Oh, Hudson, I'm really excited for you. Wow.
Hello? Anyone home?
Mother! It's so good to see you! Hudson! Louisa! Mother's home!
Mother!
Mom, I have some great news to share with you. You'll just love it.
I already know the news you speak of, my son.
How do you know? Did Amelia break her promise? She said she would tell no one, but she guessed it.
I assure you, it was from no human source that it was revealed to me. I was praying for you. In fact, I took one whole afternoon and spent it in prayer for you. It was a Wednesday. And after much prayer, the Holy Spirit gave me an assurance that he had saved you.
That was the day I was reading one of Father's little booklets. You know, the tracts that he passes out? I wasn't going to read the entire thing, only the exciting story at the beginning. But then I found myself reading the entire booklet. I found out what it really means to be a Christian. Here, I wrote it in my journal at the exact time. I'll surely be when you said. No, wait. This is your journal, Amelia. What is this? My name is here.
Son, you shouldn't read her journal.
Don't read my journal.
I vow right here before Jesus Christ to pray 3 times a day for my brother, Hudson Taylor, until God answers my prayers with his salvation. It was dated exactly 1 month before it happened.
You had 2 of us praying for you. God answers prayer. So where's your father? Let's go tell him the good news.
All right.
Brought up in such a family and saved under such circumstances, it was perhaps natural that from the beginning of my Christian life, I was led to feel that the promises of God were quite real and that prayer was a matter-of-fact communication with God. Not many months after my conversion, I remember specifically and with all sincerity, putting my life, my friends, my family, my all upon the altar. A deep consciousness that I was no longer my own took possession of me, and to this day has never diminished. Within a few months, the Lord began to burden my heart for China, and that he wanted me there. It seemed highly probable that the work to which he was calling me might cost me my life. See, China was not as open then as it is now. My desire was to learn more of China. And providentially, I was able to borrow a book about China from a minister in my local town there. He asked me why I wanted to read it. And I told him, well, I believed that God had called me to missionary service in that land. He then asked me, well, how do you suppose that you will get there? And I said that I believed that I would do as the 12 and the 70 had done in Judea, and I would go without purse or without wallet, and I would rely solely on him who called me. His response was one of concern, yet kindness. I remember he placed his hand on my shoulder and he said kindly, my boy, you will grow older and wiser than that. Such an idea would do very well in the days when Christ was on earth, but not now. Well, I have grown older, but evidently not wiser. I am more convinced than ever that if we were to take as our assurances and as our guide the assurances that our Savior gave us, that he gave to his first disciples, we would find them just as suitable to our times as to when they were originally given. Now, I understand that this way of thinking or trusting is not normal. But I believe that God was using this mindset to prepare me for China. One such time of preparation took place when I was working in Hall for Dr. Hardy. See, Dr. Hardy paid me for my work, but it barely covered my rent and expenses. And as a believer, I believed that it was important that we should tithe as well. So that left me with pretty much nothing. I knew that if I was going to make a good missionary, that I had to learn to trust God for everything, even my finances. Well, Dr. Hardy, he was a forgetful man. He would frequently forget to pay me when my pay was due. Worse yet, he asked me to remind him when it was time. I was not comfortable with that. So I prayed and I asked God, God, would you remind Dr. Hardy to pay me when the pay is due? And the Lord saw fit to allow Dr. Hardy to forget for weeks at a time. One Saturday afternoon, about 5, I was working in his office and he had not paid me. 2 weeks passed. My rent was due and I had nothing to eat the following day. After much prayer, the Lord gave me an assurance that everything would be all right.
Well, I am just about through for the day. All my prescriptions have been filled, and I've seen all my patients. Isn't the Lord good, Hudson? You know, it never ceases to amaze me at all the good things that our Lord does for us from day to day. I was just reading in His Word just a day from the book of Psalms. The psalmist was crying out to God for help, and then praising Him at the very same time for His goodness and kindness towards him. It just reminded me how we can be crying and complaining to God in one moment, and during our complaint, He takes us into His presence with some blessed assurance of all we find. And we end our prayer or our song in thanksgiving and praise for His bountiful blessings. Taylor, don't you agree?
Oh, yes, sir, absolutely.
Oh, by the way, Taylor, are you not due for your salary again?
Yes, sir.
Am I late?
Yes, sir, it's overdue some time now.
Oh, I'm so sorry. You did not remind me. You know how busy I am. I wish I thought of it only a little sooner, for only this afternoon I sent all the money I had to the bank. Otherwise, I promised I would pay you at once. Oh, well. Hudson, the pan is blowing over. Oh. Well, I will be going home now. I will pay you what I owe you next week. Well, please lock up when you are finished. Good night, Hudson.
Good night, sir. Oh, dear God, forgive me for my fear and struggling heart to accept what you are doing. Father, I had your peace earlier, and it seemed as all was going to be well. But now, it's as bad as ever. He will not pay me now until Monday, and he has owed it to me for some time. Should I have told him it was due 2 weeks ago? He must know that I have to pay rent, and that I have no other means. Well, I guess I can be thankful for when it comes. It will be a rather large amount. I have nothing to eat. So I suppose you're asking me to fast tomorrow. I can accept that. But what about Miss Finch? She needs her rent money. She is a kind Christian woman. I cannot take advantage of her like this. She'll want it when I get home tonight. Listen to me. I don't sound like a man of God, a man of faith. How can I ever go to China? Lord, make me into a man who knows how to trust in you. Take away my fear and doubt. I will not leave this place until I have the blessed assurance that you have given me faith, peace, and joy back into my heart. Thank you, God, that Miss Finch goes to bed early She'll not be waiting for me when I return late tonight. There I go again, Lord. Thank you for this time of trusting in you. You say in your word that you will provide all that I need. Thank you for doing that. I don't see it. It's not in my hands. But I trust in you, and you will not let me down. I praise you, for you are a mighty God. I may not have the faith that I need, but I trust in your faithfulness. Thank you. Thank you.
Oh, Hudson, you are still here. The most incredible thing has just happened. Hand me that ledger over there, would you? One of my richest patients just stopped by my home to pay his doctor's bill. I think it's such an odd thing to come out this late on a Saturday night to pay a doctor's bill.
Seems he could have just as easily dropped it in the post or even waited till Monday.
So, now I had to come back here to make sure all got logged in correctly. You know how forgetful I am. I would not remember to do it on Monday for sure. That. It's all logged in correctly. Well, I see you're getting ready to go as well. We can walk out together. Would you put this ledger away for me? Thank you. By the way, Hudson, you might as well take these notes. I have no change, but I will pay you what I owe you next week. I am sure it is more than this. Oh. Isn't that funny? Here I thought I wasn't going to be able to pay you till Monday.
I returned home that evening. I fell on my knees and I thanked God. I was confident he was preparing me for China. God was not through teaching me yet, however, as finances were not the only thing that I needed to learn to trust God over. I began to take more exercise in the open air to strengthen my physique. I wanted to be physically ready for China as well. I had taken my feather bed away and sought to do away with all comforts as I could. I wanted to be properly prepared for the difficulties that China would bring my way. He even learned to live solely on brown bread and water. And at times I'd have my baker only cut the loaf in half so that I would not be tempted to eat the entire thing. One evening, as I was sewing some papers together to make a notebook for a class that I had the next day, I managed to prick my finger with the needle that I was using. Coincidentally, the next day we were to dissect the body of a man who had died of a fever. This was a potentially dangerous procedure. It had to be done with much care, as one small scratch could cost one his life. The next day, a little time into the procedure, I began to feel weak. And later I had to hurry out because I was quite ill. After splashing some cold water on my face, I felt a little relieved, at least enough to go back into my lecture that afternoon. But before long, I again was sick. I was unable to hold my pencil or even take notes. By the time the lecture was over, I was having severe pain in my sides. Not only was I feeling ill, I was looking it as well.
Well, class, next we'll be talking about diphtheria. Oh my, would you look at that? I seem to have gotten a little over talkative. Please remember that I will not be here tomorrow, and Dr. Parker will be filling in for me. That is all. You are dismissed. I will see you all at the beginning of next week. Thank you.
Taylor, what's the matter with you? You look very much under the weather, my friend. I better go get a nurse. I need someone's help, quick. It's Taylor. Hang on, Taylor. I'll be right back.
Taylor. You don't look well at all, my friend.
I cannot think what has come over me, being sick like that. It's just, it's all so strange.
Seems clear enough to me. You must have cut yourself while dissecting. And now you have a case of malignant fever.
Doctor, do you really think so?
No, I'm sure I did not. I was very careful.
We are always very careful, especially since we had a student die of that very same thing.
He wasn't the only one. There's a second one, and he's very ill with the same thing. He won't make it.
Wait, I pricked myself in the finger with a needle while still at home. Could it be possible that the wound was still unclosed?
That was probably the cause. All I can tell you now, Hudson, is that you need to get a cab, quickly, and get home as fast as you can, for you have no time to lose.
Unless I am terribly mistaken, I have work to do in China, and I shall not die. Not that I'm afraid to die, for that would mean I would be in the presence of my master. Just the prospect of it brings me great joy. But at the same time, I know I am called to China, and I'll somehow be brought through this.
That's all very well, but get a cab and drive home as fast as you can, for you have no time to lose. Sorry to say, Hudson, but it doesn't look well for you at all.
Well, I'm not going to get a cab.
Mr. Taylor, I'm here to help you get your things together. Oh my, you really are unwell. Let me help you.
Please, can you take this bowl and fill it with hot water and bring it to me right away?
Yes, sir.
I beg of you, miss, you must accept eternal life as a gift from God through Jesus Christ.
If you say so. Sir, what is the bowl of hot water for?
Place it on the desk there. Don't look.
What are you doing?
My uncle sent his own physician later to check on me, and he stated that if I had been living a moderate life, that I might pull through. But if I had been going in for beer and that sort of thing, there would be no manner of chance for me. I thought that if sober living had anything to do with it, few would have as good a chance as I. As little but bread and water had been my diet for some time now. I did eventually make a full recovery. And God used events like this and many others to prepare me for the work that he was calling me to in China. You know, you all look like you could use a break. Why don't we take a 10-minute reprieve and I'll pick up after that time. Thank you. I hope that your brief moment of stretching will find you more comfortable and less fidgety as we continue. I believe that we paused right before the time in my life where God finally saw fit to send me to China. This was an exciting time. The years of anticipation were finally over. I was leaving London. I remember the day well. It was September 19th, 1853. My mother had come to see me off. I'll never forget that day. How she went with me into my cabin, which was to be my home for nearly 6 months. We knelt down. She prayed the last mother's prayer that I was to hear before leaving for China. For my sake, she restrained her feelings as much as possible. But after we parted, I watched her. I watched her as she went on shore and she followed the ship as we went toward the gates. As we passed through the gates, the separation really began. I shall never forget the cry of anguish that I heard from my mother that day. I never knew so fully until then what God so loved the world meant. And I'm quite sure that my mother learned more of the love of God that day than in all her life before. Oh, how it must grieve the heart of God when he sees his children indifferent to the needs of the world for which he died. As hard as it was, I remember that day with fondness. It was an exciting time. I was headed to China. But that excitement quickly turned into turmoil, turned into trying times due to extreme and varying types of weather. We had reason to fear our lives multiple times, let alone make it to China.
It doesn't matter what kind of weather we are having, this trip is going to kill us. First, it was the violent storms that dragged us into the shallow waters. And now, we are stuck with breezeless days that are leaving our sails hanging lifelessly.
Sir, shall I set out the longboats, or at least turn our front end around?
That won't help us very much. I'm afraid this current we are in is much too strong for our rowers.
We occasionally get an evening breeze. Maybe we could set them down and benefit from them.
I'm afraid we just won't last that long. Dr. Taylor, would you come out here?
Yes, sir. What's wrong?
Doctor, we will be lucky to last half an hour more without any wind. We are stuck in a current that is rapidly drawing us into some shallow reefs ahead. What is to become of your call to the Lord in China?
Sir, I have passed through previous times of conflict that have tested my faith. And what I have learned from those times enables me with great joy to tell you that I'd rather be in no other position, and I strongly expect to reach China. But if this doesn't happen to be the case, my master will find it a good thing that I was found laboring to obey his commands.
Well, Doctor, I hope you're right, for we have done all that we can, and now all we have left is to wait.
No, sir, there's one thing we have not yet done.
What is that?
Four of us on board are Christians, the carpenter, the steward, myself, and you. Let us each agree to return to our own cabins and ask the Lord to give us breeze immediately.
Doctor, you are right. I am challenged by your profession of faith in our God, and I support your recommendation. Let us ask the Lord for some assistance.
Good sir, I have spent the past few moments in prayer to God, asking him to give us breeze to escape these shallow waters, and I'm convinced that it will be coming immediately. Please let down the corners of the mainsail.
Do not tell me how to do my job. I've learned from my years in the sea that a good mind and common sense are far more effective than some with faith and an unseen gospel. You say wind is coming. I say I'd rather fear than hear spoken. What the?
Don't you see it? The wind is coming!
Nah, it can't be. It's only a cat.
Cat's paw or not, I beg you, please let down the mainsail and let us at least benefit from it.
Fine, whatever you want.
Yes, yes, do you feel it? We're moving!
Doctor, would you believe it? God has answered our prayers. We must certainly be moving at 6 or 7 knots now. Praise the Lord.
I told you, sir, God has plans for me in China, and I will do all in my power by honoring that call.
What a treacherous trip that boat ride was. My first trip to China. The first of 24 boat rides so far. When we landed in Shanghai on March 1st, 1854, difficulties did nothing but surround me. The land was in war, and I was instructed to live inside a settlement which was for foreigners. The problem was that these apartments for foreigners were hard to get, regardless of how much money you had. I was fortunate to make contact with the Dr. Lockhart, who put me up for 6 months. At that time, I decided to go against the wisdom of men, and I rented an apartment outside of the settlement. I also decided that I would adapt some of the Chinese dress. The standard missionary dress was black robes, which had consequently earned us the name Black Devils. These changes began to open up doors for me for missionary work, at least for a few months. When the French joined in the war, my city became a dangerous place to live. Once a fire broke out in the house next door, and I climbed to my roof to see if it was necessary for me to escape. While up there, a ball flew over my head and hit the ridge of the roof next door, showering tile all over me. Those were indeed troublous times. And it's tough to convey the horrors and the atrocities that were connected with the war that I witnessed. This was not the first prolonged war to hit China during my time there. And even when war seemed to rest, the hearts of the natives were still callous. They were indignant. They were even hateful toward each other. Once, while traveling from Shanghai back to Ningbo, we were sailing along the coastlands to take advantage of the many ports along the way. It just so happened that one of those days I had the opportunity to go on shore to preach the gospel to the multitudes that lined the banks there. On the boat ride in, I had the opportunity of meeting a man who was well traveled, a very intelligent man, a Chinese man. But strangely enough, he went by the name Peter.
Quite clearly demonstrate the looks of a native Chinaman. So tell me, how did you get the name Peter?
Oh, yes. I have been outside of China many, many times. It is actually in your homeland, Ingrin, that I first went by the name Peter. You see, every time I meet a foreigner, I tell them my name is Peter. It's so much easier that way.
So, while in England, did you hear any mention of the man Jesus Christ?
Oh, yes. Yes, I did. I was always being very curious about that man. The things I've heard of him are just simply astounding. Son of God, come to earth as a man, died for the sins of man, but not dead any longer, but now in heaven, reunited with God. It is so interesting, but I don't understand it all.
Wow, I'm impressed with all that you know of him. The good news, however, is not only did he die for our sins, so we don't have to, he also sent his Holy Spirit to reside in those who put their faith in him. And because of this, we are not only forgiven of our sins, but we don't have to sin. We have the ability to choose not to sin.
Oh, this is all very interesting. Maybe on our return trip back to the ship, you can tell me more about this.
I would love to do that. But even better yet, I'm actually heading on to shore to speak more about what we were just discussing. Maybe you could join me.
Oh, yes, that would be wonderful, yes.
If you give me a minute, I need to head back to my cabin, where I need to get some books that I plan to pass out after I speak
today. Okay, yes, please.
What just happened? What man? Where's Peter? It was Peter!
What can we do? There's a fishing vessel over there.
Hey, over there, come quick! A man is drowning, I tell you!
It is not a convenient time.
Don't talk about convenience right now. A man is drowning.
We're busy fishing and cannot come.
Never mind your fishing. I'll give you more than you can earn fishing for an entire week.
How much will you give us?
We don't have time to discuss that now. I'll give you $5.
We won't do it for that. Give us $20 and we'll drag the net.
I don't have that much money. Just come at once and I'll give you all that I have.
How much may that be?
I don't know exactly. Maybe $14?
Okay, we're coming.
The boat paddled over and let down the net in less than a minute. The body of Peter was brought up. The fishermen were indignant because they had to wait what they thought was a ridiculous amount of time to get their money while I made all my efforts at reviving Peter. All my efforts were in vain, however. Peter was dead. To myself, this incident was profoundly sad, yet so full of significance. We would most certainly find these fishermen guilty of this poor Chinaman's death, especially since they had the means to save him, but chose not to use them. Yet, I must pause. Before pronouncing judgment against them, and I must ask, is it more wicked a thing to let the body die or to leave the soul to perish? Has not the Lord commanded us into all the world to preach the gospel to every creature? Shall we say to him, no, it is not a convenient time? Shall we tell him that we are busy fishing and we cannot go? That we have purchased 5 yoke of oxen, or we have married, or we have engaged in other more interesting pursuits and we cannot go? Let us learn a valuable lesson from these fishermen. Let us remember, let us pray for, yes, let us labor for the unevangelized, or we shall sin against our own souls. Let us not forget, he it is who said in Proverbs 24, deliver those who are being taken away to death, and those who are staggering to the slaughter, oh, hold them back. As you can tell, Peter's story brought me to sober reflection. I give God thanks for times like this. But I also give God thanks for the times when life's circumstances bring us joy. For some time, I found myself in Ningpo as a place of residence. Not always did I have my traveling companions with me, and so I would become lonely. During that time, I had come in contact with a local school for girls. It was run by a lady missionary. She went by the name Mary Ann Aldersey, but I would much rather call her a she-devil.
Good morning, ladies.
Good morning.
Oh, there you are, Miss Aldersey. Ling Su is in need of your attention.
Good morning, Miss Dyer. And how are you this fine morning?
I'm sorry. Good morning, ma'am. I'm fine, and how are you?
Couldn't be better. Did you sleep well?
Yes. Fine. Well, I believe I woke with a slight headache.
It's because you don't have discipline to care for your body in this place like I do. You must rise at 5 a.m., go out to the wall and exercise. Breathe in the fresh morning air. Headache, you say? Here, take some of this.
What is it?
Hartshorn. I take it all the time to relieve headaches. It's also a fine antidote for ill odors. So, what was the problem with Ling Su that you and your very capable sister could not take care of this morning?
Well, it's a disciplinary matter, ma'am, and we know how you wish to address those kinds of things yourself.
And you feel that it couldn't wait till I was done with my daily routine? Well, I will see to it and return later. Don't drink too much.
Oh, there you are.
I had to come get Miss Aldersey to take care of Ling Su.
She woke you up too, huh?
The whole house heard her. I don't think any of us are used to waking up at this hour.
Miss Aldersey, of course, already out there on the wall and didn't hear a thing. I don't know how she does it.
Discipline, dear sister, discipline. And a shot of her spirits. Here, want to try some?
No, thank you. Oh, what is this stuff anyway?
She told me, but I forgot already. Did he sleep well? Until the rude awakening, I mean.
Oh, I don't know. I've had so much to think about lately.
You? I'm the one getting married. I think I should have much more to think about.
Of course you do. But that's just it. You're getting married.
And so will you, Maria. Soon, I believe. Or I should say, God willing.
Of course, if God is willing. I wouldn't want it any other way.
You've been thinking about Hudson Taylor again, haven't you? Well, has he spoken to you? Is there any indication that he feels the same way about you?
I believe so. You know, I see him frequently when I'm over at the Joneses' place. Since I've been spending more time with Mrs. Jones, he and Mr. Jones are very good friends. He was only here for 7 weeks, but when he left to go back to Shanghai, I really missed him.
He came right back, Maria.
I know. And that made me so happy. I could hardly keep from smiling when I saw him. He's so dedicated to God, and he has such a hunger to share the gospel with the Chinese people.
I actually thought that you and he would make a fine pair from the first night we met him. But then he started wearing those clothes and dyed his hair in the queue. Well, I just have to say...
Don't say it, Barella. Everyone talks about him like that, but it doesn't bother me in the least. In fact, I agree with him and feel it's the best way to reach the Chinese people.
Boy, you must really be in love. Have you told Miss Aldersey about this?
How can I tell Miss Aldersey about anything? She's so outspoken of her bad opinions of Hudson. Every time she sees him, she speaks ill of his appearance and methods. That's what makes this so much harder.
Who is the letter from?
Hudson.
He wrote you, Maria? What does he say to you? This is a proposal of marriage.
Is that what you think it is? I couldn't be sure.
There is the word marriage right there.
He says the possibility of marriage. I guess he's just trying to find out if I'm interested.
Well, have you answered him? He calls you spiritually minded and a true missionary.
He says a lot of nice things. I want to say yes, but I fear what Miss Aldersey would say.
What would I say about what? What is that?
A letter. A gentleman is interested in Maria's hand.
What gentleman?
Hudson Taylor.
Hudson Taylor? That poor excuse of a human being? Don't even say the word gentleman when talking about him. He's a disgrace to all missionaries, parading around in those silly clothes and that ridiculous pigtail.
It's called a queue.
I know what it's called. He has the most unorthodox methods of sharing the gospel that I have ever seen. How are we supposed to get these people to learn civilized English ways if we dress and look like them? He wasn't a bad-looking chap before he changed himself to be so utterly ridiculous. Obviously, he is not in his right mind. Should have known this would happen. Letting you girls out on your own and the likes of him. Come preying on my girls.
We've only spoken a few times.
Oh, Mr. Taylor. That poor, unconnected nobody. How dare he presume to think such a thing? The proposal must be refused at once, and that's final. Does he ask you for a reply?
Yes. He would like to know if I would be interested in a marriage.
So you will give him an answer.
What should I say?
I'll tell you exactly what to say. You will be brief and to the point, and you will simply state that what he desires is wholly impossible, and that if he had any gentlemanly feeling whatsoever, he would refrain from ever troubling you again on the subject, Maria.
That sounds so cold.
Maria, you were not actually considering it, were you?
He's been so kind to the Joneses, and she cared for his children while she was sick.
My John speaks very highly of Mr. Taylor from the many travels they have made together. He seems like a fine man to me.
Oh. See, you've both lost your heads. I agreed to match you and John Burden. He's a good man. But Mr. Taylor, I can see that the Joneses are going to be a problem here. Mr. Jones is Taylor's friend. Miss Jones is your friend. Obviously, they would like to see this match take place. Well, the next time that I see Miss Jones at the ladies' prayer meeting, I will let her know that you belong in a different social circle than Mr. Taylor. He's an independent worker, called by no one, connected with no one, recognized by no one as a minister of the gospel. He is fanatical, undependable, diseased in body and mind, and in word, totally worthless.
It is amazing. How can time can heal some wounds? And one can actually look back on certain events that were initially painful and smile somewhat humorously at them. At the time, I was shocked and very disappointed when I received Maria's note of rejection. It seemed so unlike her. I, however, did quickly learn that it was Miss Aldersey that was really behind the cold and abrupt note. With the help of some friends, Maria and I were able to meet and openly share our mutual feelings for each other. She agreed to my writing her uncle to see if we could pursue our relationship. It took a few weeks, but finally, word came back from her uncle, Mr. Tarn. He had done some inquiry about me and had found that everything seemed to check out all right, so he gave his approval. Special meeting took place and was set up in a home of some missionary friends of ours. Maria was invited over, not knowing that I was waiting there with her uncle's reply and an official proposal of marriage. We were finally married, and we were happy. A little over a year Later, Maria gave birth to our first child, Grace. But as quickly as our spirits can be in the clouds, they can go to the deepest depths. We went on to have 9 other children, 5 of which died under the age of 2. Then, after a very short 12 years of marriage, my beloved Maria contracted cholera and passed away. This was a tough loss for me. And my own health consequently began to decline. But again, our God is so faithful to his promises. When he says, "Lo, I am with you always," he means it. As he always does with the weary, he restored my soul. He encouraged my broken heart. He brought joy again to me. In a short amount of time, I met and married my current wife, Jenny Faulding. She has been such an encouragement and support to me. God again shows that he is good all the time. Before I close this evening, I wish to share with you one more story to demonstrate again how God is faithful to his promises. As you know, God used me to start the China Inland Mission, but it was only God who kept it running. See, our finances were always an up and down thing. Once, we only had 87 cents remaining in the balance books. But even then, we had all the promises of God.
Dear, how are you feeling? Can I interest you in a cup of tea?
Sure, I'll have a cup. I'm feeling okay. Still a little weak. This illness has definitely given me too much downtime. My thoughts are never good when I have this much idle time.
Just what exactly are you thinking about?
I was reading something I wrote in my journal a couple months back.
What does it say?
January 27th, 1874. Ask God for 50 or 100 additional native evangelists and as many missionaries as may be needed to open up the city still unoccupied in Xinjiang. Also for men to break into the 9 unoccupied provinces. Ask in the name of Jesus, I thank thee, Lord Jesus, for the promise whereon thou hast given me to rest. Give me all needed strength of body, wisdom of mind, and grace of soul to do this thy so great work.
So, what are your thoughts when you read this?
Do you know what happened the day I wrote that, Jenny?
No, what?
I was out evangelizing on the streets one day and met a young gentleman named Dizing. After discussing with him for some time, he told me that there was a question that disturbed him greatly and which he cannot find an answer for. He said, "What am I to do with my sin?" Many people told him not to worry about it, for there is no future state. But he did not believe them. He said he lies alone at night to think. He sits alone during the day to think. But this question keeps coming. What am I to do with my sin? I had the great joy of telling him what to do with them. He left me that day very comforted.
So what are your... How does that relate to what you wrote in your Bible?
I was so overjoyed by that experience and others like it that I was convinced where this is where God wanted us. And that he wanted me to pray for more workers. But if it was just me he was going to use, I prayed for strength to do it.
Oh, so you wonder why you're sick instead?
It is a bit odd to me that I prayed for workers and he sent none. And I prayed for strength and he sent illness. I just don't know what he is doing.
Hudson, this isn't the first time we've had to wait on God's timing for things.
You are right. But what makes matters worse is our finances. We've been telling our supporters in London that we're heading into the interior, and the need is great for more workers, but we cannot support the missionaries we already have here.
Hudson, this too is God's doing. We must continue to wait on him.
You were right. I just desire so much to see these provinces evangelized soon. We're doing so well. I pray for this every day. I long for this every night. But it can't be that God cares less.
Dear, we know God cares greatly for the native people. And we know that he will provide in his way and in his time. We must continue to wait on him.
Your mail, ma'am.
Thank you, Hunan.
What have we received today?
It looks like a letter from Miss Blatchley and two letters from England.
Let me see the letter from Miss Blatchley, please. Oh, it's not going well for Miss Blatchley. She has been sick for the last 2 weeks. If I wasn't so ill, I would go and check in on her.
Hudson, listen to this. This letter is from a young child named John who heard of our work in China. Encloses 50 cents. It's not much. But see, God will provide even through meager means.
You're just trying to make me feel better. Let me see that other letter. Jenny, listen to this letter. My dear sir, I praise God for you all. I find your letterhead beautiful when it reads, "The Lord our banner, the Lord will provide." It is my desire and plan to place at your disposal £800 towards the further extension of the China Inland Mission. If faith is put forth and praise sent up, I'm sure Jehovah of hosts will honor it. £800?
Hudson, this is fantastic news.
Oh, what a doubter I've been. God has not been unfaithful to me. On the contrary, I have been unfaithful to him. Jenny, this letter was mailed months ago, before the need was even there. God's word is so true when he says, "Before they call me, I will answer." Lord, thank you for this provision and forgive me for my doubt.
It was God's plan to put me in similar situations over the years, more times than I can count. And it is with experience and confidence that I say to you that God is with us and his promises can be fully trusted even to the end of the age. This is my message. And some of you may wonder why I have talked about God's work in my life instead of issuing a plea for more workers. Well, I have learned a couple things about this over the years. One, to obtain successful laborers, elaborate appeals for help are not nearly as effective as the earnest prayer to God to thrust forth laborers into his harvest. Another lesson that I have learned is that successful laborers will come more effectively when the spiritual life of the church is so deepened that men and women will be unable to stay at home. Therefore, I encourage you tonight not to make any decisions this evening, but rather take home what you've heard here this evening and pray about it. For I desire that no commitments be made from human persuasion, but rather from the affirmation of the Holy Spirit. Again, this is my message. Thank you. You have been a great audience. God bless you all. You are dismissed.
Thank you, Dr. Clay.
Brothers and sisters in Christ, tonight we have had the opportunity to hear from a remarkable man with a remarkable vision. I know the evening's brochure advertising tonight's event said that no money would be taken up, but I know many of you would be upset if you could not give. I'm sure Dr. Taylor would not mind if we did.
Excuse me, Dr. Chairman. Chairman. You may be a doctor too, I don't know. I beg you, please keep the conditions that we agreed to. If after much prayer the people want to give, they can give to any missionary society with missionaries in China, or they can give to our London office as well. Again, as I said, you are dismissed.
Why not let them give if they want?
Chairman, I believe that a collection tends to leave the impression that giving and money are the important thing, whereas no amount of money can convert a single soul to Christ. What is needed is men and women filled with the Holy Spirit to give of themselves. There will be no shortage of funds for such people.
Well, there you have it. It's certainly been good being here this evening. God bless and have a great night. You're dismissed.
Thank you.
It's almost showtime and Diver City's waiting on me. We got a packed house, the crowd is calling out. They want the beat to drop, but what we really need is you. If you want to steal my show, I'll sit back and watch you go. If you got something to say, go on and take it away. Need you to steal my show, can't wait to watch you. Something more than smoking lights. So I'll step out the way, I'll give you center stage. Alright, spotlight, give them what they came for. If you wanna steal my show, I'll sit back and watch you go. If you got something to say, go on and take it away. Need you to steal my show.
My son, why are you striving? You can't add one thing to what's been done for you. I did it all while I was dying. Rest in your faith, my peace will come to you. When I hear the praises start, oh, I wanna rain upon you blessings that will fill your heart. I see no stain upon you because you are my child and you know me to be your only holy. makes only what you do for me. My child, why are you weeping? You will not have to wait forever. That day and that hour is in my keeping. The day my child, I wanna rain upon you blessings that will fill your heart. I see no stain upon you because you are my child and you know me. To me, you're only holy. Nothing that you've done remains, only what you do with me. What you do for me. My precious bride, the day is nearing when I'll take you in my arms and hold you. I know there's so many things that you've been hearing, but you just hold.